The Boeing B-47 Stratojet was the world's first swept-wing bomber, a pioneer that revolutionized aviation design. When it first took to the skies in 1947, it looked like nothing else on Earth. With its six engines suspended under razor-thin wings, it seemed to have arrived from the future. The B-47 was not just a looker, it was also blindingly fast. In 1949, it smashed the cross-country speed record, flying from Washington State to Washington, D.C., averaging over 600 miles per hour, faster than any previous bomber could dream of flying. This extraordinary aircraft played a crucial role during one of the most dangerous moments in human history. During the Cuban Missile Crisis of 1962, B-47 reconnaissance variants assisted U-2 spy planes in providing photographic evidence of Soviet missiles in Cuba, directly influencing President Kennedy's decisions as the world teetered on the brink of nuclear war. The B-47's innovations weren't confined to military use. Its revolutionary design, those swept wings and potted engines, became the template for virtually every large jet aircraft that followed, including the Boeing 707 that ushered in the age of mass air travel. From its record-breaking speeds to its Cold War espionage, from its nuclear deterrence role to its lasting impact on commercial aviation, the B-47 Stratojet didn't just push the boundaries of flight, it redefined them entirely. Even as World War II raged on, American military strategists were already looking beyond the current conflict. In June 1943, with the outcome of the war still uncertain, the United States Army Air Forces, or USAAF, took a bold step towards the future of aerial warfare. Aircraft manufacturers received an informal inquiry from the USAAF to explore designs for multi-jet planes. The focus was on developing aircraft suitable for swift reconnaissance photography or medium-range bombing missions. This forward-thinking initiative aimed to create an aircraft that could outpace enemy interceptors and penetrate deep into hostile territory. At the time, the backbone of America's bomber fleet consisted of propeller-driven aircraft like the B-17 Flying Fortress and the newly introduced B-29 Super Fortress. While formidable, these aircraft were approaching the limits of their performance capabilities. The emerging jet engine technology promised speeds and altitudes far beyond what propeller aircraft could achieve, but it also presented new engineering challenges. On November 17, 1944, the USAAF solidified its vision by issuing formal requirements for a jet-powered medium bomber. The project's requirements were notably demanding. The proposed aircraft needed to cover vast distances, operate at extreme altitudes, and achieve remarkable speeds. Specifically, it was expected to fly 3,500 miles without refueling, reach heights of 45,000 feet, and travel at speeds up to 550 miles per hour. This set off a fierce competition among America's leading aircraft manufacturers, including Boeing, North American Aviation, Convair, and Martin. The initial concepts for jet bombers were essentially adaptations of existing designs. Boeing's first study, known as the Model 424, was little more than a scaled-down B-29 with four jet engines. Their next iteration, the Model 432, featured four engines buried inside the fuselage, fed by intakes beside the cockpit. While innovative, these designs still clung to many conventional bomber design principles. The true breakthrough came in May 1945, just as World War II was ending in Europe. A team of American scientists and engineers, including Boeing's chief aerodynamicist George Scheirer, visited Germany to examine captured aeronautical research. What they discovered would change the course of aviation history. Scheirer encountered German research on swept wings, a concept that promised to dramatically reduce drag at high subsonic speeds. Excited by the potential, he immediately sent a message back to Boeing's design team in Seattle that simply said, quote, "Stop the bomber design." This laconic directive set in motion a complete redesign of what would become the B-47. As World War II came to an end, the urgency for this new type of aircraft intensified. The advent of nuclear weapons had fundamentally altered the nature of warfare, and tensions with the Soviet Union were rapidly escalating into what would become known as the Cold War. The USAAF, soon to become the independent United States Air Force, recognized an urgent need for an aircraft that could deliver nuclear payloads over vast distances with speed and precision. Boeing's design team, led by George Scherer and Ed Wells, worked feverishly to incorporate the swept wing concept into their bomber design. The result was the Model 450, which featured a 35-degree wing sweep, six jet engines mounted in pods beneath the wings in a sleek, streamlined fuselage. The USAF was sufficiently impressed with this radical design to award Boeing a contract for two prototypes, designated XB-47, in April 1946. Just 16 months later, on September 12, 1947, the first XB-47 rolled out of the factory. The most striking feature of the XB-47 was its 35-degree swept wings. This radical departure from conventional straight wings was not merely aesthetic, it served a crucial aerodynamic purpose. The sweep angle was designed to delay the onset of shock waves as the aircraft approached the speed of sound, theoretically allowing the XB-47 to fly at much higher speeds than its straight-winged contemporaries. The wings were also incredibly thin and flexible, a design choice that initially concerned test pilots. However, this flexibility would later prove to improve the aircraft's ride in turbulence and increase its structural efficiency. Another revolutionary aspect of the XB-47's design was its engine configuration. The prototype was powered by six General Electric J-35 turbojet engines, mounted in pods beneath the wings, four in two twin pod arrangements near the fuselage, and two in single pods near the wingtips. Considerably different from most contemporary designs, this configuration simplified engine maintenance as the pods could be easily accessed. It also kept the wings free of complex ducting, allowing for a simpler, lighter wing structure. Additionally, spreading the engines along the wingspan saved some structural weight by reducing the bending moment at the wing root. What's more, the XB-47's landing gear configuration was unlike anything seen before on a large aircraft. To accommodate the large bomb bay and the thin wings, Boeing engineers developed a tandem bicycle landing gear arrangement. Two sets of dual wheels were placed in line along the fuselage centerline with small outrigger wheels retracting into the inboard engine pods for stability. This unusual setup required a special takeoff technique. The aircraft was built to rest on the ground at the proper takeoff attitude, eliminating the need for rotation during takeoff. The XB-47 was designed with a three-person crew: pilot, co-pilot, and bombardier navigator. The pilot and co-pilot sat in a fighter-style tandem arrangement under a bubble canopy, while the bombardier navigator was stationed in a compartment in the nose, with windows for visual bombing. Compared to the heavily armed bombers of World War II, the XB-47's defenses were rather minimal. The prototype was designed to feature two 50-caliber machine guns in the tail, though these were not installed for initial flight testing. This reflected a new philosophy in bomber design that prioritized speed and altitude over armament, believing that the best defense was to avoid interception altogether. On December 17, 1947, exactly 44 years after the Wright brothers' first flight, the XB-47 thundered down the runway at Boeing Field in Seattle. Pilots Bob Robbins and Scott Osler guided the sleek silver aircraft into the air for the first time. For 27 minutes, the prototype cruised over Washington State before touching down at Moses Lake Airfield. While this maiden flight was a success, subsequent tests revealed challenges inherent to the B-47's revolutionary design. The aircraft wobbled in a Dutch roll, yawing and rolling in an oscillating dance. At high speeds, the ailerons twisted the flexible wings instead of rolling the aircraft, a phenomenon dubbed aileron reversal. Boeing's engineers tackled these issues head-on. They developed a yaw damper system to counteract the Dutch roll and added vortex generators to the wings to improve airflow. By 1949, these modifications had transformed the XB-47 into a stable, controllable aircraft. In June 1950, the first production model, the B-47A, rolled off the assembly line at Boeing's Wichita plant. The B-47A featured more powerful General Electric J-47GE-11 engines, each producing 5,200 pounds of thrust, a significant improvement over the prototype's J-35 engines. It also introduced a framed canopy, replacing the XB-47's bubble canopy, and a pair of 20mm M24 cannons in the tail with an A2 fire control system. In addition, it featured the K2 bombing navigation system, significantly enhancing its operational capabilities. However, only 10 B-47As were built. These aircraft served primarily as testbeds, allowing the Strategic Air Command, or SAC, to develop tactics and procedures for jet bomber operations. In 1950, while the B-47A was still in its limited production run, Boeing initiated the YB-47C project. This variant aimed to replace the B-47's 6J-47 engines with four Wright T-35 turboprops. However, development issues with the T-35 engine would eventually lead to the project's cancellation in December 1952. In 1951, the B-47B made its debut, marking the Stratojet's transition from experimental aircraft to frontline bomber. This version featured more powerful J-47 GE-23 engines capable of producing up to 5,800 pounds of thrust each. The B-47B also introduced the capability for air-to-air refueling, drastically extending its range. A total of 399 B-47Bs were produced. As B-47Bs entered service, Boeing continued to explore alternative propulsion systems. The XB-47D program began, converting two B-47Bs to carry a pair of Allison XT-38A2 turboprops in place of the inboard jet engines. While this variant didn't enter production, it provided valuable data on the feasibility of turboprop-powered bombers. In 1953, the B-47B underwent significant improvements under the ebb tide program. This initiative saw the addition of ejection seats, enhancing crew safety. The program also introduced a more reliable bombing and navigation system, improving mission effectiveness. External fuel tanks, each holding 1,780 gallons, were added to increase its range further. The same year, Boeing unveiled the B-47E, the definitive version of the Stratojet. This model featured uprated J-47GE-25 engines with water injection, providing a crucial boost of power during takeoff. The water injection system increased thrust by about 10% for takeoff and could be used for about 2.5 minutes before the water supply was exhausted. The E model also boasted a larger fuel capacity of 14,610 U.S. gallons and an improved electrical system. The B-47E was equipped with an A5 fire control system and armed with two 20mm M24 A1 autocannons with 350 rounds of ammunition each in the tail turret. A notable sub-variant was the B-47E4, featuring a strengthened landing gear, airframe reinforcement, and greater fuel capacity. Its maximum takeoff weight was increased to 230,000 pounds, and it could carry up to 25,000 pounds of nuclear weapons in its bomb bay. The B-47E's enhanced capabilities made it the backbone of SAC's medium bomber force. Over 1,341 B-47Es were produced, forming a formidable deterrent against Soviet aggression. This included specialized variants such as the EB-47E electronic countermeasures aircraft and the RB-47E reconnaissance variant. As B-47s populated SAC bases across the United States and at forward locations worldwide between 1953 and 1957, the aircraft underwent further modifications. The milk bottle program replaced key wing fittings, further enhancing the B-47's durability and addressing structural fatigue issues identified during operational use. During this period, reconnaissance variants, designated RB-47, joined the fleet. These aircraft, stripped of bombing equipment and bristling with cameras and electronic surveillance gear, probed the edges of Soviet airspace. Their missions were dangerous. Several RB-47s were shot down by Soviet fighters, but the intelligence they gathered was invaluable. In 1956, the B-47's capabilities were put to the test in one of the most daring reconnaissance operations of the Cold War. Codenamed Operation Home Run, this mission saw a fleet of RB-47 reconnaissance aircraft conduct deep penetration overflights of the Soviet Union. Taking off from Thule Air Base in Greenland, these aircraft crossed the forbidding Arctic to gather vital intelligence on Soviet air defense systems, missile sites, and other military installations. However, not all the B-47 operations ran smoothly. During a training mission on March 10th, a B-47 accidentally dropped a Mark VI nuclear bomb near Tybee Island off the coast of South Carolina. Fortunately, the bomb was not armed and did not detonate. While this specific incident was a one-off for the B-47, it highlighted the risks associated with nuclear-armed aircraft during the Cold War era. Meanwhile, as its service career progressed, the B-47 continued to evolve. The TB-47E served as a training aircraft, while the ETB-47E was used for combat crew training. The DB-47E was modified to control QB-47 target drones, showcasing the versatility of the Stratojet design. By the mid-1950s, the B-47 had truly come into its own, proving to be a remarkable aircraft that pushed the boundaries of aviation technology and played a crucial role in shaping Cold War strategy. However, perhaps the Stratojet's finest hour would come in 1962. On October 15th, as Cold War tensions between the United States and the Soviet Union reached a boiling point, reconnaissance aircraft, including RB-47s, intensified their surveillance of Cuba. While U-2 spy planes provided the primary photographic evidence, RB-47s played a crucial support role in gathering intelligence. The discovery of Soviet medium-range ballistic missiles being installed on Cuban soil sent shockwaves through Washington. These weapons were capable of striking most of the continental United States. Over the next 13 days, as President Kennedy and his advisors grappled with the crisis, B-47s maintained a constant presence in the skies. Reconnaissance variants conducted daily overflights, monitoring the buildup of Soviet forces. Bomber variants stood on high alert, engines idling on runways across the United States, crews ready to scramble at a moment's notice. The presence of these aircraft, along with other elements of American military might, sent a clear message to Soviet leader Nikita Khrushchev. On October 28th, Khrushchev announced that the Soviet Union would withdraw its missiles from Cuba. Without dropping a single bomb, the B-47 had played its part in pulling the world back from the brink of nuclear catastrophe. While the B-47 didn't see combat in the Vietnam War, it continued to serve in reconnaissance and support roles during this period, further demonstrating its versatility and enduring value to the Air Force before eventually being retired in 1977. However, the B-47 Stratojet would leave a legacy that extended far beyond its military service. Its revolutionary design, featuring swept wings and pod-mounted engines, became the template for virtually all large jet aircraft that followed. This DNA is evident in everything from modern airliners to military transports, with the Boeing 707, the aircraft that ushered in the age of commercial jet travel, owing much of its design to the Stratojet. Today, aviation enthusiasts can still admire this groundbreaking aircraft in person. While no B-47s remain in flying condition, several examples are preserved in museums across the United States, including the National Museum of the United States Air Force in Dayton, Ohio, the Strategic Air Command and Aerospace Museum near Ashland, Nebraska, and the Castle Air Museum in Atwater, California. These carefully maintained aircraft serve as tangible reminders of the B-47's crucial role in aviation history and its enduring impact on aircraft design.